Simply put, you cannot use the iPad as a computer replacement. Well, at least that's what I would have told you last year going into WWDC with iPadOS 16 on the horizon. But now a year later, Apple has seemingly addressed all the concerns that I had in iPadOS 17, or have they? Well, today we're talking about everything that Apple addressed in iPadOS 17, including all the features that are brand new, some of the features that are still not working, like kind of a gross oversight if you ask me, and how Apple can address those features before the fall when iPadOS 17 comes out. My name is Mike, let's get started. Starting with number one, FaceTime. Now, FaceTime gets four new features in iPadOS 17, all of which are really quality of life improvements. The first feature coming to FaceTime in iPadOS 17 is the ability to leave a voicemail when making either a voice or a video call with FaceTime. I know voicemail, hey, listen, it's the future. Now, on the receiving end, if you're someone who gets a FaceTime voicemail, I'm able to view that message from my device in the FaceTime app and then give you a call back from there. I can even save the message. Now, the second feature coming to FaceTime in iPadOS 17 is the ability to make FaceTime calls using an external USB camera. Now, I think this is a great improvement coming to FaceTime because really that camera on the iPad looks like a potato cam. You can use a USB webcam, or it could even be a mirrorless camera like I'm using here to record this video, and connect it directly to your iPad via USB-C or USB-A. And not that everyone has a mirrorless camera, but you might even have a webcam that you can pick up for $60, $80, $100 and get better quality out of it than you do with your iPad FaceTime camera. Now, the third and final feature coming to the iPad in iPadOS 17 is messaging effects. This allows you to convey extra context while on a FaceTime call, just like how you do in the Messages app. These effects include hearts, storms, excitement, laser beams, and there's a couple other ones. Now, I've tried it with an iPad Pro, an iPad Mini, and an iPad Air, and it does work on all those. If you have a device that's not working on, let me know down in the comments below. Now, the second group of features coming to the iPad and iPadOS 17 are improvements to Stage Manager, which many people, including myself, are excited for because it greatly improves the usability. Many of you who are watching this video really want to use your iPad as a computer replacement because not only is it thin, light, and portable, it also is highly conformable, and it really makes the iPad, a very easy default choice to pull up and start using. So first, there is significantly better window management in iPadOS with Stage Manager. This feature is a big improvement because windows can be moved around freely without conforming to any special sizing. It's almost as good as the Mac, not like for like, but in a way it's certainly far better than the first iteration, which was iPadOS 16. Now, the second feature coming to Stage Manager in iPadOS 17 is the ability to add apps to an existing stage with just a click of the mouse. This can be done in one of two different ways. If you're in tablet mode, so you're holding the tablet, you can hold your finger on the top bar where the hamburger menu is, and then you can choose the app with your other hand that you wanna go ahead and open. Or if you are in keyboard mode, you can hold down the command key, all right, and use your mouse or the trackpad to click and open the other app. Those apps can be anywhere that you find them, including whether on the dock, whether they're in the app library or on the home screen. Now, the third feature coming to Stage Manager is the ability to configure Stage Manager in the preferences and settings and have it apply to new windows. Now, the setting itself isn't new because it was there last year, but how it reacts is a little bit different. So if you open up settings, navigate to multitasking, and you go to where you select one of the three different multitasking modes. The first option is gonna be single app, the second option is gonna be split view, and the third option is going to be Stage Manager. If you choose Stage Manager mode, anytime that you add an app, whether it's from the dock or from the app library, it automatically enables Stage Manager so you don't have to actually turn it on. You don't have to go to Control Center and hit the toggle to do so, which it just cuts down on the number of keystrokes, which is just, it's a benefit, it's a quality of life benefit. Quality of improvement, quality of life, quality of experience, there you go. Now, the next set of features I want to discuss is coming to notes in iPadOS 17, covering, again, three core improvements. First is the ability to add a link to an existing note. This will be done one of three different ways. I can long press on the screen and choose link to note. I can use a keyboard shortcut, which is Command K, or I can input a right-facing chevron to get the context menu and link to a note. Second, the Notes app gets much improved PDF handling, allowing me to add several PDFs to a single note and seamlessly scroll through them. Adding PDFs was new last year, a single PDF, but now you can have multiple PDFs in the same note and it just handles it. It's a little bit more graceful. I've had instances where it crashes the Notes app, so this year it's doing a little bit better at that. And then third and finally, it's the ability to add a new font, which they're calling mono-styled or mono-style. Now, I use mono-style to add a quote or draw my visual attention to something, letting me know that's something I should be important paying attention to. Moving on, the next thing Apple fixed in iPadOS 17 is the health app. Now, I wouldn't necessarily call it a fix, and I wouldn't say that the health app isn't particularly sexy, like no one's like batting down the door saying, give me the health app on the iPad. But still, for a certain demographic of people in their mid-40s, like me, there's a tangible benefit to viewing this type of information on a larger screen. I don't have to pull out my glasses. I don't have to pull out my cheaters. I can just view it on the iPad. And especially on the 12.9 inch iPad, it's great. Now, the next set of features coming to the iPad and iPadOS are enhancements to your iPad's home and lock screen. Several improvements are coming this year, and it really brings the iPad to parity with the iPhone from last year's iPadOS 16 or iOS 16. But then it also elevates both the iPhone and iPad up on that level with new features specific to this year's release. First, you can create a lock screen experience which uniquely reflects your own style. Everything from the clock font, the wallpaper itself can be customized. You can rotate your wallpapers like throughout the day, throughout, you know, every time you wake it up, giving you several different wallpaper options for that. You can link your lock screen to a specific focus mode like you can on the iPhone. You can add blur, stylized photo effects. It's all very well thought out, and I would say it's probably more feature complete than it was last year in iOS 16. Now, you can edit your lock screen in one of two different ways. First, if your device is locked, you can press down on the screen while the device is locked and you'll get the edit menu. Or second, you can navigate to settings, wallpaper, and choose add new wallpaper. The second change coming to the home and lock screens is gonna be interactive widgets. You can have a different set of interactive widgets on the lock screen depending on the orientation. So whether it's in portrait mode or landscape mode, you can have different widgets that are gonna be displayed to you there. Now, this is really cool because it gives you the ability to really granularly change your iPad depending on how you use it and which orientation you're using it. Now, in the public beta release, only the first party apps from Apple are interactive. And if an app has widgets that are available on the iPhone, they're automatically available on the iPad as well. So you shouldn't have to like look for new apps. They should be automatically available. Now, the final enhancement coming to the lock screen in iPadOS 17 is live activities. Now, I don't know how much sense this makes to bring live activities on a device that doesn't have the dynamic island, right? We're hopefully gonna get a new iPad Pro, I think this fall, but if not, it would be March of next year. But I would appreciate the iPad Pro if it had thinner bezels, because then the FaceTime camera would be recessed into the dynamic island. But I think kind of more broadly, it makes sense in the context of Apple releasing a iPad-like device that is like a home hub where you can, you know, everyone can manage their life, so to speak, on the home hub. That's where I think it makes more sense. And I actually did talk about that in a previous video, which I'll link in the cards above. Moving on, all the features coming to the lock screen in iPadOS 17 in terms of customization apply to the home screen as well. This includes interactive widgets and the ability to place those widgets anywhere on the screen, which is a new feature this year in iPadOS 17. This means that widgets can be placed anywhere, unlike iPadOS 16, where the widgets were kind of bound to predetermined locations and they always had to be adjacent to an app. For some reason, I have no idea. But now this year, you can place an app anywhere. You can have one screen with one small widget, and that widget can be anywhere. It could even be in the middle of the screen, which is a nice enhancement because, again, you get to use the iPad the way that you want to use it, and you're not bound by Apple's quote-unquote silly logic. Now, next up, this feature I'm going to talk about is not specific to the iPad and iPadOS 17, but it's a really big quality of life improvement for any of those who are using AirTags. Now, new in iOS and iPadOS 17 this year is the ability to share an AirTag with someone. So whether you want to keep track of your kid or your dog, you can share the AirTag or access to the AirTag with anyone, including your spouse or a loved one, which makes total sense. Previously, like my wife couldn't see my son's AirTag, and I always had to be the one to told her. She couldn't see it if I wasn't available. It was just, again, real kludgy the way that it was done, but this year it's a much more refined user experience. Now, privacy is getting several enhancements, including calendar and photo access. So now I can grant read or write access to my calendar and to my photos, but I'm also getting an occasional reminder saying, hey, listen, you've enabled this access for this app. They have access to your metadata. They have access to all your calendar invites. Do you want to go ahead and continue this? It's almost like the location sharing that was done, I think, is in iOS 15 or iOS 16. They're bringing that now to more things that really hold sensitive information, much like your calendar, much like your photos and metadata. I would actually like to have the ability only to view photos and not get the metadata from that. That would be a feature that I would be looking for. Now, Autocorrect is getting updated, allowing for much better use of what I would call a customized dictionary that is unique to you and applies to both the software and the hardware keyboards. So if you're writing ducking a lot for some reason, you shouldn't have to rewrite that all the time. It should allow you just to use the word that you want to use without actually auto-correcting you to ducking. Now, inside of Safari, there are really two changes that are coming that are worth noting. First improvement is going to be the addition of browser profiles. Now, this allows you to have one set of bookmarks, search history, cookies, tab groups, etc., associated with a personal profile, and then a completely different set of information associated with a different profile like work or professional. This makes the data distinct and separate. I really like this feature, and I want Apple to build this out a little bit more. So when I change my focus modes, there's a focus filter for which browser profile are you on. I haven't seen that yet, but I would expect that to come to the beta very soon, if not maybe in a future release of iPadOS 17. Now, the second improvement locks your private browsing tabs behind your password or biometric authentication. So it's nice that you don't have to worry about people creeping in on your browser tabs and seeing what you're searching for. Now, next, there are gonna be improvements to Siri, and I apologize in advance if I activate your Siri. First, you can activate Siri just by saying Siri. You don't need to say, hey, Siri. Second, just like the HomePod today, your iPad can handle multiple concurrent timers, which is kind of amazing that we haven't had that, seeing that it's been on the HomePod for, I think, maybe at least 3 years. And finally, you can activate Siri while on a voice call and ask her to do things, which is new. To get to this feature, you go to settings, you go to Siri, and then choose Siri on calls. Next is AirDrop, and the speed and reliability of AirDrop has been greatly improved. I don't know, it's probably about 2 or 3 years, maybe since the day of the iPhone 12, where it just felt like AirDrop is slow and sluggish constantly. And I get these timeouts when trying to send messages or trying to send AirDrop something from my phone to my Mac or vice versa. And now it's lightning fast. I don't have those problems anymore. There's also improved PDF support throughout the OS, where first you can autofill PDF information either from a phone capture or a photo capture or from a document, which is like magic the way that it is. It's a great feature. And second, when you open up a PDF on your iPad, it actually opens up the PDF in a separate window. And that window is not bound by the same constraints that the PDF is itself. So you can move it around independently. The last improvement coming to iPads that have it on one chip or later is going to be improved external display support. So there's two different aspects of that. First, if you're using an iPad with an external display, and let's just say that external display does not have speakers, you can connect your iPad to a pair of headphones, like Bluetooth headphones, and get the audio that way, where before you could not. Second is if you have your iPad connected to an external display and that external display has a webcam, you can then use that webcam for FaceTime, which is going to be new this year as well. Now, with all the new features and improvements in iPadOS 17, there are still several features that do not exist. Either they're completely just not there or they have yet to be fixed in iPad. And the first one, it's so obvious to me, and it's gonna be obvious to you once I say this, but you cannot use your iPad in clamshell mode. If I close the lid of my iPad while connected to the Magic Keyboard and an external display, it actually sleeps the iPad display. This is probably the silliest thing I have ever heard, because I would think that the team who's developing these features are saying to themselves, okay, we're gonna launch external display support. Like, what are the features that are kind of adjacent or that you'd wanna use to the, you know, with this? And I would think that, you know, using your iPad in clamshell mode is right there with a feature that should be bundled together. Now, this next one, it really grinds my gears on both sides, because I experienced it on my iPad Pro, I experienced it on my iPad Mini. It is so frustrating that you cannot differentiate the app layout or the app density per device. It actually makes the iPad Mini look atrocious. There is no calculator app in 2023. I have no idea what they're doing there. And I would say the last feature that I'm really surprised that Apple has not brought, even though it's been hinted at, you could see it today if you're running an iPad that has at least iPadOS 15.4, if I'm not mistaken, you cannot unlock your iPad using your Apple Watch. The feature has been available in the settings menu. So if you go to settings, you swipe down, pull search, and you type in unlock, it'll show unlock with Apple Watch. But this feature is there. Maybe it needs more testing. Maybe it needs more refinement. But I would love to see the unlock my iPad with my Apple Watch, just like I do with my iPhone. Now, I want to know from those of you who are watching, is the iPad powerful enough to replace your home computer, your computer that you have right now? Or are there features missing for you in order to make the switch? Now, comment down below. If you made it this far, drop a dolphin emoji so I know who made it to the end. My name is Mike. It's been great talking to you guys. I'll talk to you in the next one.